Now, Father, in Jesus' name, we pray that there will be no distraction to distract us, to hear the words as they fall from our lips today, that we will define what resurrection is, that we will get rid of all the distortions and the commercialization of this grand, most sacred holiday. Bless us. Give us a word that will produce life and give life. In Jesus' name, amen. While you remain standing, Matthew chapter 28 is where we will be today. And I will read our text to you, and we will walk through this. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the church. Chapter 28 of Matthew, verse 5. The first fourth verse says, and for fear of him, the keeper did shake and became as a dead man. Verse 5. And the angels answered and said unto the woman, fear not, for I know that you seek Jesus, which was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen, as he said. Come see the place where the Lord, come see the place where the Lord lay. He is not here, for he has risen, as he said. I want to talk to you about the indisputable evidence in the midst of chaotic world. You may be seated. Provide hope in the midst you say to them? And there was one pastor called Reverend Paul Orchard, who said that I would talk about the encounter narrative. He said I would talk about the encounter narrative, that Easter is a encounter narrative to the encounter narrative. I will explain to my congregation that Easter is an encounter. It is an encounter narrative. They asked Cardinal Timothy Dolan, what would you say? He said, I will tell them that Easter is about goodness trumps evil. That the goodness of evil trumps, the goodness trumps evil. He says that Christians believe that Jesus was crucified. He died on Friday.
Wow.
But he rose on Easter Sunday. This him rising from the dead trumps evil. My colleague in ministry, he asked Dr. W. Frank Winston, what would you talk about today? He said, I'm going to talk about hope is uninsulted. It is uninsulted. You cannot assault hope. Our hope is in God. And throughout these incidents that we encounter, with fear blanketing this global community, that in the resurrection story,
wow,
you can find hope.
Yes.
The hope is lying. The hope is listed within the resurrection story. Eric McDowell, and I did not allude to this early on, wrote a book entitled Evidence That Demands a Verdict. Within his book entitled Evidence Demands a Verdict, he began his presupposition with this whole idea that there was no real resurrection. In fact, he begins his presupposition with this whole idea that God does not even exist. And he attempted to disprove the very existence of God. And as he began his research, piece by that book, Evidence That Demands a Verdict, he discovered that there was more evidence to point that there is a God, and that the resurrection story is a valid story. He said, if you turn to the cycles of life, and the sequence of life, and how there's synergy within our lives, he said, it only points that there is something greater than us. There is a God. It was a dark day there in Jerusalem on that Friday. Hope had vanished. It was a dark day. Everything that Jesus did and everything that Jesus taught to his disciples, they had abandoned him. They had left him. Jesus died by himself. From the cross, he gave seven utterances from the cross that day. The first one was the most profound, and the last one's even greater. The first one said, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. The seventh was, Father, in thy hands I commend my spirit. And between the forgiveness and him now welcoming God to take his spirit, he brought hope to us. He brought hope that we never had. Thank God for the hope that we had. In this chapter it says now Jesus is buried, He had died. They placed him in the tomb. This was a tomb that he took no ownership. It really was a tomb. He died. Are you listening to somebody? He died. That cannot be disputed. He died. In fact, if you go to Jerusalem, they have a death certificate on record that Jesus died. But the problem, if you go to the cemetery where they deposit his body, the record will show that we put him in the tomb. But the body of Jesus can never be exhumed. That's a fact. My wife and I, we were so privileged to go to Jerusalem, and we were blessed to see what it meant. When these women came to Jesus, notice the disciples had abandoned Jesus and went back doing the very thing that he called them from. But these women, thank God for women. They knew, that's right, they knew that the story wasn't over. They knew that there were work to be done for the final interment of his body. Women came prepared. Now, the work of Jesus Christ did not begin in Bethlehem. For the work of Christ and the redemptive work of Christ predates Bethlehem. It was in the Garden of Eden when man had sinned. And man was trying to cover his sins with the skin coats of animals. When God shows up, he said, "What you have done cannot be covered by what you have done. It needs the blood of Jesus." And how many here know that it's the blood that covers us? It's the blood that makes us whole. And so in Bethlehem, we only have in Bethlehem the revealing of the work that was done through 42 generations. And it was only consummated at Calvary. The work of Jesus Christ was consummated at Calvary. Are you listening? The work of Jesus Christ was consummated at Calvary. I know I'm very clear that many of you have heard that it's white man religion because the Europeans have distorted, have tried to rewrite history and said Jesus was a white man in order to dismiss people of color. But if you take an honest look at all the evidence that Jesus was a man of color, even the Bible alludes to the fact that he was a man of color. He was so colorful that even the Bible said he was lovely to look upon. But it was not in his beauty, but it was in his work. And in the setting, the geographical settings by which Jesus was reared out of, we know that there are people of color. So he was a person of color. He almost looked like you and I. He may have been a little shade lighter or darker. And he was born like many of us was born. He was born in obscurity. He was born poor. He was born in a family of modest means. Born to a lady who was a peasant who was poor. But this poor Jesus came to seek and to save that which was lost. and their sins. He came to reconcile us back to God. Aren't you glad that we have a way that we can get to God through Jesus Christ? I announce to you today, I want you to hear this. If you agree with me, you can affirm it. Jesus is the answer. I said, you can affirm it. I said, Jesus is the answer. Do you know he's the answer? To be the word affirm me, I believe. Do you know that Jesus is the answer? If you know that he's the answer, say, he is the answer. These ladies came prepared to prepare the body of Jesus. When Jesus died, they took him and placed him in Joseph's tomb that was meant for him. Caesar gave an edict. I don't want to tell you the story. Caesar gave the edict that the stone was to be placed and then that the seal and his insignia was to be placed on it. And if anybody would break it, they'd be guilty of death. And he placed in front of that seal all guards. Because the rumor went out, and if you can read it in the text, it's in the Bible. The rumor went out that in order to give validity to what Jesus said, because Jesus predicted his death. He said, I'm going to die. He said, but I'm not going to allow nobody to take my life. I'm going to give up my life. And that information was circulated around. And he said, in 3 days, I'm going to rise again. And to the disciples, that was hard to believe. Although he had performed miracles of raising people back from the dead. He raised Lazarus from the dead. He raised the young boy who was headed to be buried and turned in the cemetery from the dead. But how could he raise himself from the dead was the question that disciples had. Although they were with Jesus, they really didn't know who Jesus was. I want you to know this, brothers and sisters. A lot of people who go to church don't know who Jesus is. A lot of people praising God don't know the power of the praise. See, the Bible says bodily exercise, profit little. If you're just doing this just to exert yourself, you're missing it. See, when you do real praise, when praises go up, come on, help me, blessings come down. Why do we say that? It's not just a cliche, it's for real. You know, some people say, oh, all those cliches. No, when praising, because the Bible said that our God inhabits the praise of the saint. And David told us, let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. And so when you come to the house of the worship, you are to enter his gates with thanksgiving and enter his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him, for the Lord is good. How many in here have a praise right now to give God? Open your mouth and give him a thank you, Jesus. You know, brothers and sisters, you don't have to thank long and hard about praising the Lord. I don't know who did this, but I'm going to provide you an opportunity right now to thank him. If he woke you up this morning, which he did, you ought to thank him. Come on, if you got a roof over your head, you ought to thank him. I heard this young couple say they just bought their home. You ought to thank God that you're able to get a home and get a mortgage and get a down payment. Thank you, Jesus. If it had not been for the Lord on my side, where would I be? I owe him a thank you. And right now, I don't know if you thank him when you woke up this morning, but everybody in here ought to text says that these women came prepared. Now, you remember a few days earlier that Mary Magdalene poured precious ointment upon the body of Jesus. And Jesus said, they said, that's wasteful. Jesus rebuked his disciples and said, if you only knew that what she's doing is preparing, is prepping my body for my burial.
Amen.
And let me know another thing. When they came, these ladies didn't come unprepared. Do you remember when the wise men, they brought Jesus 3 gifts? Bought them gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Myrrh was a spice that they would put on dead bodies to preserve. So these ladies now comes with the myrrh. Mary's mother had the myrrh that was given to her by the wise men. And she brings that. She brings that after 33 years. She held on to that to bring it, to place it upon the body of her son. Mary Magdalene was a prostitute that Jesus saved, that Jesus won, and her life was converted. And she was there. She would never forget how the message and the touch of Jesus changed her life. See, the undisputable evidence that I have to let you in on, that when you ever come in contact with Jesus, every person who came in contact with Jesus came in suspicious and left out blessed. They came in with unresolved issues, and their issues were resolved. If you go throughout the whole narrative, the biblical narrative, there are more stories of how Jesus' teaching transformed the lives of people who heard his teaching, how Jesus healed the sick, how Jesus raised the dead, how Jesus fed those that were hungry. He was not a hustling preacher, but he was a preacher that had a message. They came prepared. Are you listening? But when they approach, and I'm about finished, when they approach the tomb, they notice 2 things. The seal was broken. And the stone was rolled away. And the guards who were supposed to protect Jesus had vanished. An empty tomb. The seal unbroken. The stone, come on, talk to me somebody, rolled away. And the very people entrusted in keeping the scene secure is now gone. But, oh, I'm getting excited. Always look out for that but. The but in the English language is conjunction, is continuation. The story is not ended. Although it looked bleak and long, although it looked hopeless, somebody said but. Yeah, but. But listen, I'm saying but. The seal is broken. The stone, I'm getting excited, is rolled away. The guards who were supposed to protect the scene now vanish nowhere, but they meet up with 2 angels.
Yes.
I said, isn't he good? I can't hear nobody. Isn't he good? God will never leave you with unanswered questions. That's what I want you to know. The unexplainable evidence of the resurrection of Jesus Christ simply means that your questions can be answered with an open mind. If you come to the Bible with a preconceived idea, you're narrow in your thinking. You're narrow in your view. You might well go ahead and be an atheist. Because people who are atheists are very narrow in their view. How do you explain away winter, spring, summer, and fall? How do you explain away the birds singing in the morning, every morning? How do you explain away darkness come at night and light come at day? How do you explain the weather pattern? How do you explain that when somebody's sick, they call on the name of the Lord and they are healed? Have I got some witness in here? When you've been sick, you call on him. How do you explain that? How do you explain when you get in trouble? When your back is against the wall and seems like your foundation is caving in and all hell is breaking loose and you cry out, Lord, help me. And some way, somehow, unexplainable, he helps you. How? I've got evidence that he's alive. Would you holler and tell somebody he's alive?
To these
they are now distraught. Think how would you feel? You going to prepare for the interment of your son. You have a final viewing. Think about that, women. It's horrible to think when a mother got a family, their child. I dread that I never have to walk and experience that pain. It is normal for children to bury their parents. But some people have to bury their children. Oh, what a pain Mary had. Oh, how distraught Mary Magdalene was. That the one that touched her life and changed her life is now gone. But they had the opportunity to perform the final act. That was to prepare the body of their loved one and to intern them by having the final view. But his body, Mother Hall, is gone.
Thank you.
today. We serve as we stand on business.